is love, daring love, eternal love of God. The theme, nothing is impossible for God. Nothing is impossible for God. And we're going to sing out that song by Caroline Gillette as the hymn of the day. And we are reminded again that God's love is eternal. And we know and affirm our faith that nothing is too hard for God. Please stand as able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who comes to set us free, the mighty Savior who comes to show mercy, the dawn from on high who guides us into peace.
Amen.
Let us come before God in confession. To you, O God, we lift up our souls.
You know us through and through. We confess our sins to you. Remember not our sins. Remember us with your steadfast love. Show us your ways. Teach us your paths. And lead us in justice and truth. For the sake of our goodness in Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen.
Children of God, come with joy and draw water from the well of salvation. Remember the gift of baptism. Your sin is washed away in the name of Jesus. You belong to Christ. You are anointed to serve. Stand up and raise your heads. The reign of God is near.
Amen.
Amen.
Shepherd of Israel. Stir up your strength and come. Restore us, O God, let your face shine upon us, and we shall be saved.
Surely God is my salvation. I will trust and will not be afraid. For the Lord God is my strength and my might, and has become my salvation.
We praise you, O God, for this wheel of time that marks our days of preparation for Christ's advent.
As we light the candles on the street, open our eyes to see your presence in the lowly ones of this earth. Enlighten us with your grace, that we may sing your advent among us in the Lord-made flesh. Grant this through Christ our Lord, whose coming is certain and his day draws near. Amen.
Come, all you want. The first lesson is from the 7th chapter of 2 Samuel, verses 1 through 11 and verse 16. Instead of David building a house for God, God promises to establish David's house forever. Centuries later, after the Babylonian exile, no king sat on the throne. Even then, however, the people of Israel remembered this promise and continued to hope for a king, the Messiah, God's anointed. Now, when the king was settled in his house and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See now, I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan. "Go and tell my servant David, 'Thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day, but I have been about moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Whenever I have moved about among all the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?' Now therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, 'Thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep to be prince over my people Israel. And I have been with you wherever you went, and have cut off all your enemies from before you. And I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and to plant them, so that I may live in their own place, and be disturbed no more. And evildoers shall afflict them no more as formerly, from the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel, and I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, if the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house, your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me, and your throne shall be established forever." Here ends the reading. Today we will read in unison that you may be identified, Luke 1, verses 46 through 55. And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in my God, my Savior. For he has looked with favor on the lowly state of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed. For the mighty one has done great things for me, and holy is his name. Indeed, his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has come to the aid of his child Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham, forever." The second lesson is from the 16th chapter of Romans, verses 25 through 27. Paul closes his letter to the Romans by praising God because in the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ, God has revealed the promised divine plan of salvation for all humanity. Paul proclaims this gospel of Christ in order to bring about the obedience of faith among all nations. "Now to God, who is able to strengthen you, according to my gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but is now disclosed, and through the prophetic writings is made known to all the Gentiles, according to the command of the eternal God, to bring about the obedience of faith to the only wise God through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever. Amen." Here ends the reading.
Amen.
girl was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her, who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. The Gospel of the Lord.
How are you? Good. Are you good? Ready for Christmas?
Lots. I agree. There are lots that's missing. Who's missing? And the right. Your first mom. Baby Jesus is missing. Mary and Joseph.
Angel.
What about the shepherds? And the three wise men. That's right. Now, what do you know about Mary and Joseph other than they were Jesus' parents? What do you know, Caroline?
That Jesus watches us wherever we go.
That's right. Jesus does watch over us wherever we go. But do you know that Jesus was born to humans, Mary and Joseph? Do you know what Joseph did? Joseph was a carpenter. So he worked with his hands. So just ordinary people like us, right? Yeah. Isn't that cool? So let's put Mary and Joseph, and the baby Jesus. So I need three of you, Rory, Marion, Britt. Can you go set them in the nativity? Can you go over there and set them? Marion will help you, Britt, if you're not sure. Can you put baby Jesus in there? Yeah, good job. So now we have Mary and Joseph and the baby Jesus. Now, what's on the top?
A star.
A star. That's right. What did that star do?
Went down by where Jesus was.
That's right. It shined and showed where Jesus was. Now, who came and spoke to both the shepherds and the wise men, even though they were in very different places, who came down and spoke to them? Who spoke to the wise men and the shepherds?
The three kings.
No, that's the wise men. You've been saying it. Have wings, and you guys are all
angels.
That's right, you guys are all angels. There you go. That's right. The angel went to the wise men and the shepherd, and she told them not to be afraid, right? King of all has been born, and you are to follow the star to find them, right? So she not only told the richest of the rich, who was the wise men, right? Remember, they brought gifts. She also told the lowly shepherd, who all he had to give was his faith and his love. That's pretty cool. That shows us that Jesus is for all of us, isn't he? He's for all of us. He loves all of us. Okay, so who wants to finish this? Robert and Sam and Caroline and Russell. Okay, there is a wise man. There is a wise man. There is a wise man. Grab the sheep and give Caroline the angel. You gave her both of them, didn't you, sweetheart? Okay. Can you put them up there? Put the wise men together. You can set her wherever you want, honey. Thank you, sweetheart. So now we have the story of Jesus' birth, right? So tell me, what's the one thing you know? What's the one thing you know about Jesus' birth? What's the one thing you remember? You're killing me. What is Jesus? He was born a human, right? Because he was born to human parents. He is also our Lord and Savior, right? So that's pretty cool. So he was born just like us, to human parents. Say it now.
Savior and Lord is one of his names, are two of his names also.
That's right. Savior and Lord are two of his names also. So, are you all ready for our big thing tonight?
Yep.
Me too. We're excited. So let's fold our hands and repeat after me. Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
Because of your birth,
because of your birth,
we are saved.
We are saved.
Amen.
Stir up our hearts, O God, and even as we are surrounded by words and by thoughts, we pray that you would still our hearts with the stillness of your presence, with the stillness of your small voice speaking to us. We thank you for this gift of love, eternal love in and through Jesus Christ. We pray that you would sanctify us at this moment. Use us, O Lord, one more time, every time, to proclaim your gospel. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace from the triune God be with us all. Amen. The day, the time we were waiting for, not just the four Sundays in Advent, the whole year, for this time of festivity, celebration, and that brings the family together, friends together, and we celebrate our relationship, our connections, our friendship, and whatnot. The first thing we need to remember at this time, this moment, is this. Christmas is not celebration of the birthday of Jesus as an anniversary, birth anniversary. It is not an anniversary. What we celebrate is that gift of Jesus to the whole world, and through whom that gift of love, reconciliation, and salvation reaches every nook and corner of this world. So Christmas is a time that reminds us that that we are not the only ones in this world, that God loved and loves the whole of humanity. Today is the day we celebrate that John 3:16 golden verse, for God so loved the world that God gave his only begotten Son, Jesus, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. When the angel Gabriel visited Mary, does not choose and pick Mary because she is the most eligible person in the whole world. She is the one who has found favor with God. We look at Mary as one who receives that news, that experience of the visitation. And if the angel told her that you are the most favored one, God is with you, just imagine if Mary was so ecstatic with that announcement, if she thought that, yes, I am the most privileged one, period. I will keep it to myself. I will celebrate. What would it have become of this preaching of the good news? She is troubled because the implications of that announcement, that annunciation, as a human being, Mary is deeply troubled. Not just troubled. That's the word that is used in the New Testament. She's so greatly troubled. And then she follows up with questions. But how? How can this be? Two things that we connect at this point with the first reading and the gospel reading. The first reading talks about the continuity between David's throne, and Jesus. If you remember, that man who was blind, who was begging Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. It was calling out to that affirmation of faith. David's throne will last forever. But then pause for a moment. Mary is not the one who comes in the line of David. If you read the Matthean genealogy, you will find that it traces from Adam to Joseph. And we find that in this annunciation story, in this visitation by the angel, it is Mary who is promised a child. How will this be? The Holy Spirit will overshadow. Nothing is impossible, too hard for God. These questions of worry, anxiety that fill Mary's heart and mind, body and soul is all at one time just stilled. And when is that? When the angel says, your cousin Elizabeth has also become pregnant. She has also been promised a child. Now Mary, who knew her cousin and who knew her plight, I'm sure they would have shared their own experiences. Weeping, sharing of sadness, loss, whatever, disappointment, frustration. All those facts together. And for Mary to hear something about her cousin. She, in her old age, has also conceived. It is something that connects with Mary so much that at that moment she is able to connect and say, with God, nothing is impossible. With God, nothing is impossible. Once, I think in the recent few weeks ago, when I preached on that text of Jesus raising the daughter of Jairus, and you find that that impossibility becoming a possibility, the reversal of blood flow happens when Jesus, the Lord of life, raises that daughter from the dead. What the blood that had stopped flowing in her body begins to flow in Jairus' daughter, just as the body that was bleeding, hemorrhaging of that woman who was sick, the blood in her body stops flowing. So you find that Jesus, the Lord of life, the one who has power over the living and the dead, is one who is proclaimed, whose birth is proclaimed. And Mary at that point gets it. Nothing is impossible for God. So much so that she bursts out into a song. Song of liberation, song of love and justice. When we read that Magnificat from Luke's, the first chapter in Luke, what we read today in the place of Psalm, is a song that she repeats as the song of Hannah in the Old Testament. A song that connects with those who have undergone the same similar kind of pain, frustration. What is the message then for us today? In God's eyes, God's time, we are all connected and we are all under the purview and we are all in total control in God's eyes. And we are all in God's palm of our hand. God has us inscribed in the palm of God's hands. No exclusion. Absolutely. For us to get that message. So today, when we talk about our previous experiences of frustration, disappointment, trouble, disease, death, difficulty, whatever, for us to be affirmed and assured that God knows. The Emmanuel God is with us. And nothing is impossible for God. Amen.
Thank you.
confess our faith. We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
With hope and expectation, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all who await God's day of restoration. You promised mercy to Abraham and Sarah and their descendants forever. Bring your church into thoughtful, caring, and collaborative relationship with those of other faiths. Strengthen our shared values, that we work together in caring for your world. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
As fields and crops lie dormant, bless them with holy rest. Prepare them to thrive, that they provide abundant food in due season. Protect animals who hibernate, and provide for all who scavenge for food in the lean season. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
You raise up the lowly and cast down the arrogant. Teach humility to all in positions of authority. Break down systems of oppression, especially systems that perpetuate inequity and exclusion. Do not allow wealth, power, or pride to become idols that obscure your call to justice. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Look with favor upon all who cry out to you. At this time, we bring before you all those who are on our prayer list and who have sought special prayers of us. We either name them aloud or silently in our hearts at this time. Accompany all with tenderness those who are afraid or who are ill. Rescue all who experience abuse or who live under threat of violence, especially refugees, immigrants, and asylum seekers in search of a safe and a stable home. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
You are pleased to make your home among us. Make our homecomings joyful as we gather with friends, families, and chosen families in celebration. Grant safety to all who travel. Sustain the work of Lutheran immigration and refugee services. services and other ministries that assist in setting up new homes. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Blessed are you for Mary and all your servants in every generation who lived according to your promise of mercy. Strengthen us by their example until the revelation of your glory is made known. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Listen to these and all our prayers, O God of hosts, and restore us with your great and everlasting mercy. Amen. Merciful God,
we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
But deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power,
Body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
May the triune God bless you now and forever.